Savarikar ji is the chairman of scientific body pharmacopoeia commission of indian medicine and homeopathy. He is also a advisor to a honorable minister of ayush government of india new delhi. He is a former vice chancellor of prestigious gujarat ayurveda university jamnagar. He was invited by the world health organization as a ayurveda expert for who consultation of physiotherapy. I kindly invite you for the keynote address, sir.
Vasudeva sutam devam kamsa chanuramardanam sarvadeva namaskaram kesham pradigacchati. Starting from the morning, we have entered in the afternoon. That's why let me say good afternoon everybody. Too much water has been flowed in the rivers. Many things have been said. My friends, dignitaries sitting on the dais, the president of this conference, Dr. M.K. Sridharji, Honorable Padma Shri Rajesh Kotichari, Secretary, Ayush Education, Ayush Ministry, Meenakshi Negiji, Srimati Meenakshi Negiji, Director of Health Services, Karnataka, Sunilji Ambekar, the Organized Secretary of ABVP, Dr. Ramakrishna, Vice President of CCIM, other dignitaries sitting on the dais, and dignitaries in the auditorium. My friends, I am very happy to come here. I have spent almost 40 years in the field of Ayurveda. Last year, I retired from the government service as a professor. I have never addressed a gathering of so many students. Gathering means gathering for the sake of knowledge, I am saying. Cultural gatherings I have addressed, but scientific sessions, scientific gatherings, till date, they are mostly organized by the teachers. Teachers, scientists, all other dignitaries like that. But never a student, I have never seen a gathering of students who are organizing, main organizers, I will say. Of course, the backbone of every organizing, every conference are the students, but they are on the backside. They are backstage managers. On the front are always our teachers are always there. So I am very happy to come here, my friends, to address so many students are sitting in front of me. It shows that how much worried they are regarding the future of Ayurveda. Another thing which I liked is that the name Jignyasa. Actually, I was given the subject for the keynote subject as there were two options for me. One was the Indian connection behind the South Asian traditional medical system. Another was science behind traditional systems of medicine in South India, South Asia. In that connection, in that sense, in that reference, the word jijnyasa is very apt, my friends. Actually, I will say, jijnyasa is a synonym of student, I will say. It's a synonym, it should be. Unfortunately, we have forgotten that, but jijnyasa should be the synonym of the students. I hope everybody knows what is jijnyasa. Jijnyasa is inquisitiveness. Recently, just a few months back, I have addressed one gathering, one conference, which was based on orientation of students regarding the research in Ayurveda science, Ayurveda colleges. So we always talk about research. What is research? From where the research comes? Research comes from jijnyasa. Inquisitiveness is the mother of jijnyasa, my friends. So unfortunately, our education system, which we have inherited from the Britishers, Macaulay system we are carrying out, that's how we have forgotten the jijnyasa. Our teachers are not much very ready. I think Dr. Ramakrishna has given you an example that when the students ask something, the student used to say, ask the teacher to come prepared for the class. Students don't come prepared for the class. Neither they are not ready to answer the questions of the students. Otherwise, in fact, they suppress the students' inquisitiveness. You have to harbor the inquisitiveness in the students, my friends. The topic which is given to me is science behind this revolution. Now, I remember a few days back, two incidents I will tell you. One incident was, there were a series of articles in Maharashtra. There were some newspapers, there were a series of articles. The title was, the articles was, of course they were in Marathi, the title was Vijnan ki Bhakad Katha. That means, whether Ayurveda is a science or a myth. There were so many articles regarding this. They were proving that Ayurveda is a myth. It's not a science at all. My friends, today also when I got this invitation for this speech, I was just thinking about it. Where there is a question mark on this science or an exclamatory mark on this science. From my side, it is an exclamatory mark. I hope you can understand the difference between the question mark and the exclamatory mark. Question mark puts a question in front of you. That is it a science? And the exclamatory, oh, is there science? You are asking these foolish questions? You are asking science whether it is science or not? Is it a foolish question, my friends? Because Ayurveda itself stands for Ayurveda. What is Ayurveda? Veda. Veda is science. The meaning of Ayurveda itself is science of Ayurveda. It's a branch of science. So nobody can argue for that, that whether Ayurveda is a science or a myth. Incidentally, we had an interaction with the person who has written so many articles on this science of myth in Maharashtra. Then he has to agree that he was wrong. He apologized to us. But I was wrong, I was not knowing so many things are there in Ayurveda. So much science is lying behind that, my friends. Now, what is science, my friends? When somebody asks me this question, I always think, I always remember a sentence from one of the scientists. Westerner, I will give a science example of Western because always we are put in a question mark by the Westerners only. And the people, Indian people who are westernized, we say black Britishers, we will say them. So they all have this question. So this is a sentence from one of the scientists, Western scientists. He says, name is Oliver Heaviside. He says, shall I refuse my dinner? Shall I refuse my dinner because I do not know, I do not fully understand the process of digestion? Let me repeat this sentence so that everyone understand. Shall I refuse my dinner because I don't know what is the process of digestion? I don't understand the process of digestion. So the question asking the for Ayurvedic people or the even all the sciences, the South Indian Asian traditional sciences is that people don't understand. They know that this is the diet, this is your food, but they don't want to take it because they don't understand Ayurvedic. So that's very interesting, my friends. So we should not refuse that. After all, what is science? Or what is, in fact, even though the people are saying that, you might be knowing that world over, the use of traditional medicine is going up and up and up. In the recent study has been shown, the current expenditure on this traditional medicine is $60 billion. The current figure is like that. And every year it is going, emerging at the rate of 8% constantly. 8% increase, my friends. Natural products of the drug derived from natural products, 1997, best-selling product, 42% of the products are being sold as natural products, my friends. Only US is spending about $17.5 billion on the natural products. Now let us come to the traditional knowledge. Everybody is talking about traditional. What is traditional knowledge, my friends? Because we are classified as a traditional science. Ayurveda is classified as a traditional science. Yoga is called a traditional science. They don't say science, they say knowledge. But they don't know that science means knowledge. Science is a synonym of knowledge, in fact. So knowledge, know-how, skills, and practices that are developed, sustained, and passed on from generation to generation within a community, often forming part of its culture or spiritual identity. So that is traditional knowledge. So Ayurveda is a traditional knowledge. But unfortunately, WHO differs the definition of traditional. I have taken objection to the knowledge of traditional knowledge and putting, if you are the, defining the traditional knowledge, I will not put Ayurveda in the class of traditional knowledge, according to WHO definition. I have taken this objection in WHO meetings also. I was invited as an Ayurveda expert in one of the WHO meetings. I took objection to the definition of traditional medicine and putting Ayurveda in it. What this WHO definition says? They say, listen carefully, the sum total of the knowledge, skill, and practices based on the theories, beliefs, remember well, theories, beliefs, and experiences indigenous to different cultures, whether explicable or not, whether they can be explained or not, they are saying the traditional knowledge may be explainable or may not be explainable. I don't think there is a single sentence in Ayurveda is not explainable. We can understand, they don't understand it. They are not able to understand it. So that's why I said they don't know what is the process of digestion, so they are not taking the dinner. Just like that, they don't know Ayurveda, that's why they are not ready to take Ayurveda. So Ayurveda cannot be, we cannot say that the Ayurveda principles are not understandable. So that's why it is not a science. So I always take objection. I invite all of you. We should in one voice, we should say to WHO that don't put this explainable or not in front of Ayurveda. Every Ayurveda principle is explainable. Remember very well. When people say, we say the Ayurveda is Shashwat. Now when I say Shashwat, this Shashwat is a different story, my friends. People give so many examples that Ayurveda is not Shashwat. But Shashwat is regarding certain principles of Ayurveda. I will tell you many principles which are very Shashwat. They cannot be proved wrong at any time at all. Basic principles of Ayurveda are always Shashwat. We are not talking about some drug which may be effective on one person and not be effective on another person. We are talking about these basic principles of Ayurveda which are Shashwat. Shashwat means everlasting. They cannot be challenged. That's my friends. Because I read Shashwat, it cannot be put as a... Interestingly, my friends, it's a mockery, in fact, to put Ayurveda, to refer Ayurveda like that. They refer the traditional medicine as healing practices. They refer the Ayurveda doctors or Vaidyas as traditional healers. Traditional healers. Herbal medicine, herbalist, alternative medicine, complementary medicine, traditional medicine. Why? Because they say that theories and practices and experiences, beliefs, whether exclaimable or not. I object to this word exclaimable, my friends. Ayurveda is always exclaimable. And what? Why Ayurveda is a science, my friend? What is science after all? We always talk about science, science, science. What is science? Science is a systematically organized body of knowledge. Whether Ayurveda is not systematically organized, whether it is a organized body or not, it is based on observation, studies, and experimentation. A single sentence, single theory of Ayurveda, single principle Ayurveda, every single principle is based on experience, on pratyaksha. Dr. Ramakrishna has mentioned in his speech that pratyaksha. Pratyaksha, anumana, aptabdesh, these are the three basics on which the Ayurveda principles are based. If you don't understand pratyaksha, anumana, aptabdesh, forget it, that you are at fault. We are not at fault, my friends. That's why it's always foolish to put a question mark on the scientificity of Ayurveda, my friends. So there are so many traditional medicine. I will give some examples regarding Ayurveda. Now, what is the object of Ayurveda? Everybody knows that. There is much one difference one should understand. This is particularly for the bureaucrats. Fortunately, I cannot say that they are the policy makers sitting on the top posts. They don't know, understand Ayurveda at all. They don't understand. They always say whenever we interact with them, they ask us, there is metformin is a hypoglycemic agent. Do you have anything in Ayurveda which acts on a hypoglycemic agent, which reduces the sugar? They ask, there is an anti-malarial substance, drug, chloroquine, other things. Do you have any anti-malarial drug in Ayurveda? These are the general questions which are asked by the bureaucrats and people. I don't know. No Ayurveda person will ask this question, my friends. Because Ayurveda is not a science which acts as an anti-disease. It is not an anti-disease science. The basic tenets of Ayurveda say that Hetu Pratyanik and Vyadhi Pratyanik. The Hetu Pratyanik, which removes the cause of the disease, we target the cause of the disease. And you know that Padmeshwar Rajeshwar Koteja ji mentioned in his speech that there may not be a single cause of the disease. There may not be a single type of treatment for a disease. There cannot be a prescription medicine. There cannot be a standardized medicine for a particular. Ayurveda doesn't prescribe any standard medicine for a particular disease. Every individual is a different person. Although there are certain commonalities, common principles are there, but you can't say that give me a drug which will be effective for everybody. Now the modern science is also coming to that. They want tailor-made medicines for every individual. That's what we were telling from so many years back. Padmashri Koteja ji mentioned in his speech that the recent Nobel Prizes went to the people whose knowledge, whose inventions were based on Ayurveda only, on Indian science only. But why couldn't we get that? Because we don't have that exposure. That's very important, my friends. So that's why there are two objects of Ayurveda. What are that? Promotion and protection of health, and in the other side, alleviation of the disease. But alleviation of the disease through protection of health. Through protection of health. What is rasayana after all? Rasayana labhopaya hi shastanam rasadinam, shastra rasayana. That means it is not only a rejuvenation. Rejuvenation is one part of rasayana. Rasayana therapy is a tissue generation therapy. It generates healthy tissue. Healthy tissue generation is the basic function, mechanism of action of rasayana. We are forgetting that by using the word rejuvenation. Be cautious whenever you are using certain words which are given by the modern scientists to the Ayurveda terminologies. It's very important, my friends. So there means so many things are there which I can explain to you. There are a number of principles. This is, the time is very short. I can't explain each and every principle of Ayurveda. But one should remember, they are all scientific. They can be proved. The principle of sarvada sarvabhavanam samanyam vritti karanam. Principle of commonality, principle of variation. That common things promote growth, whereas differentiation promotes depletion. Is it not a shashwat principle? When it will be proved that common substance will not promote growth? Nowhere. Opposite things promote depletion and common things promote growth. Just like the principle of Pancha Mahabhuts, the five basic fundamental elements, they are primordial elements, my friends. They are not the chemical elements. I was very shocked to see in one of the exhibition, somebody had put a model of Pancha Mahabhuts. In that model of Pancha Mahabhuts, what he has shown, I was invited to examine that model. And in that model, he has put sort of five objects. It's very interesting to show, my friends, how these modern scientists take Ayurveda as such. Very interesting to show. How they misunderstand the things. There was one model of earth. Another model was there was some water was put. Another was fire was there. And then prithvi, aap, tej for agni. Then clouds were shown as in the drawing. And there four were there. And another one, I was just searching, the person was explaining to me that this is the model of Pancha Mahabhuta. He was saying, this prithvi represents earth, this water represents apa Mahabhuta, then fire represents Agni Mahabhuta, and the clouds represent Akash Mahabhuta. Then I said, where is Vayu? Where is Vayu? Then that person don't know, this is Vayu. What was Vayu? He has put one mouth. There was a man. The face of a man was put there, and a tube was inserted in his mouth. Then I said, how can it be Vayu? He said, he is blowing the Vayu. He is blowing the Vayu. Then how can you even interpret like that? He said, no, have you seen the series of Mahabharat? There was Vayvastra, where when somebody was blowing the Vayu outside it. My friends, I felt so sorry for that individual, poor gentleman, and the persons who were appreciating that model, that they don't understand what is Pancha Mahabhuta. If they don't understand that, how can they say that this is not science? If they don't understand Loka Purusha Siddhanta, universal Siddha principle, my friends, it's a science, full science. I can quote you n number of principles. I have challenged the modern scientist people. Come forward and prove that they are wrong. Maybe we are not finding the sources or the means to prove that they are correct. So much shouting is going on for evidence by science. You know that it has been said in Cochrane journals that evidence-based science is a bogus science. You don't need any evidence for that. Do you need evidence for showing that something good is for your diet, to include rice in your diet? Do you need some evidence? Do you need some evidence to drink milk every day? You don't need that. My friends, when are there, do you need evidence that the sun is giving the sunlight? No need, my friends. And proving, the methods of proving something, science, are totally different. We have it. It is definite. Another important thing which I want to tell you, my friends, students are sitting here. It's a very great thing because most of the problems are related to students. Students are our main stakeholders because we have filled our stomachs. We have enjoyed every post. We have given everything now. It's completed now. We are not worried about now. But students, their future is lying in front of them. We are producing so many students every year. Thousands of students are being produced every year. I think more than 10,000 students are graduated every year in the world. How many of them get employment in the government sector? How many of them get employment in the government sector? If the government believes, I'm using the word believes here. I will not use the word believe Ayurveda. If the belief is, they should give. So many people are shouting that Ayurveda students are not using Ayurvedic medicine. They are using modern medicine. Srimati Meenakshi, Madam, she just had told that there are 1,500 doctors in Karnataka, Ayurveda doctors or Ayush doctors are employed, co-located. I don't know what is the status. What is the machinery? What is the infrastructure given to them? Are they provided with the drugs? Are they allowed to practice Ayurveda? Or are they employed to promote modern medicine? Because in Maharashtra also, so many Ayurveda doctors are employed in the government sector. But they are employed for promoting modern medicine, to practice modern medicine, not Ayurveda. They are employed for practicing modern medicine, not for Ayurveda. So my feeling is that if we really want Ayurveda to get real promotion, I object the word of mainstreaming. Let us be independent. We want a vertical split in the health infrastructure. Vertical split, complete Ayurveda director should be different. Let our students go and then prohibit them from practicing any modern medicine. Allow them, give them complete infrastructure, give them drugs, give them paramedical help. Everything should be given and then see how they can perform. Without giving them anything, without giving even simple somebody, even Trifala Chulli is not available to my Ayurveda doctor who is sitting in the far remote area, even in Bangalore also, I don't know whether Trifala Chulli is available or not, and whether it is available, what is the quality of that drug? So my friends, we should ensure that he gets proper things to practice, and then we should talk and we should blame the Ayurveda people that they are not practicing Ayurveda. That part is modern medicine. If you are expecting that the Ayurveda practitioner should practice Ayurveda, then empower him with whatever requirements are there. This empowerment is very much essential, my friends. Students should take interest in all these things, my friends, because it is their future which is question mark. If we put a question mark on that. So definitely believe, my friends, or be sure that Ayurveda is a complete science, or I have not seen a single science, any branch of science, which is as perfect as Ayurveda. If you really study it properly, study proper Ayurveda, study proper classics, approach it correctly. Don't study Ayurveda just for the purpose of examination, passing of the examinations. Your research should be also Ayurveda oriented. Take subjects which are very nearer to Ayurveda, based on Ayurveda principles, and then only we can definitely success. My friend, I know I have taken a little bit more time. It's high time now, it's 1 o'clock. I might have been exceeded my time also. I thank the organizers for inviting me here, for giving me this speech, and I thank all of you. With the last sentence, I will finish my speech with one quotation from a scientist, which is very important and which will be an eye-opener for everybody of us, my friends. This quotation says, it's a quotation from Neil deGrasse Tyson. He said, the good thing about science, the good thing of the science is that it's true whether or not you believe it or not. That is 100% true for Ayurveda also. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.